Oh, thank you all for your patience. Okay, so again, hi everyone. You gotta love this remote world we're dealing with right now. So my name is Deborah Foley. I work with JPMorganChase. I am a design strategist, design manager. I run a cross-functional team of designers, strategists. I should update this, tech writers. Who knew I was gonna become a tech writer manager. Research has been really critical. I've run for the last 4 years a few portals, API portals, particularly JP Morgan developer and Chase developer, very much in the API management space. And we really have been doing some incredible working across the entire enterprise on kind of what banking as a service is, which is quite a challenging space in the banking industry that you're dealing with a lot of legal compliance. A lot of our approach is, you might see this before, some kind of design thinking, how we work from research data, discovery into design iterations, prototypes, into kind of incrementally building our designs. So what we have been doing is discovering in the last 4 years, almost on a monthly basis, doing incredible amount of research to understand what makes a good developer experience or what do developers want. So I am going to give you all a quiz, okay? Since this is not remote, you can't shout it out. Maybe you can use a chat space, but be kind. But honestly, I'm just gonna get you in a little bit of a thinking here of what do developers think, feel, you know, think, feel, say, or do, right? So if a user was to look at something like this, and this is actually one of the very initial designs we approached in one of our portals, and we went and talked to those users with some of these prototypes, and we asked them what they thought or say, and what do you think they said? I'm gonna give you all 1 minute to think in your mind, 1 minute, maybe less than a minute, and then I'm gonna say, stock images. All right, so what does that mean? What does that start to tell you about a developer? Let's give you another exercise here. How about if I show you this? This is actually something we came out with and at first for one of our portals, and we shared it with our developers and got some feedback. And what do you think they all said to us? Are you ready? Are you thinking it? Maybe some of you won't be surprised since a lot of you are developers, but they basically said, this is marketing fluff. Okay, I'm gonna do one more actually. Here was a real effort of ours, really trying to break down an overview synopsis of a documentation, kind of a marketing aspect of an API. What are all the best practices we want, how it works, key features, use cases, some kind of a summary. And what do you think the developers told us this time? Get us to the code. Where's the code? So, oh, actually, there's one more. What do you think when they say this? Now, many of you probably have seen this, but they actually say this is the gold standard. Okay, so, I mean, yes, I'm sure there's actually many, many more now gold standards. This has been around and we've heard this quite a bit from Stripe. They've done a wonderful job and there's many new APIs, portals out there that we keep an eye on and we quite love watching. But what does all this tell you though? And what are I'm gonna talk about today. So if we are to listen to what they say, these developers are basically, what are we thinking about them? They're smart. They're extremely, they're savvy. They build web applications, so they know exactly what you're doing and how much effort you're putting into things or not. They're efficient, they're impatient. And I can kind of say this because I used to be a developer myself. And so what does this tell us then about building developer portals and writing great documentation? And what do developers want to see? And how are we really gonna succeed then in doing a thing? So how do we, I'm gonna show you just kind of our approach. Some of this is design thinking, but by the end of this too, I wanna be able to show you some insights too, maybe with how, when you really deep dive into learning your users, learning who they are, your audience, and what they think and what they want, you can be much more specific about their needs. So the kind of the techniques, yes, Chase, we might have some resources, right? But a lot of you can do this. And I have done in other startups in my past that, you know, you can just talk to the users. That's the first thing to get. I mean, it's even worth, if you don't even have prototype, just getting a conversation with them. What are the gold standards? What are the best practices? What do you recommend we check out to understand what are the best things? Now, you really do, as I just said earlier in that quiz, you want to think about everything from what they say, they think, they do, what they feel, because you can then capture and synthesize and learn from that, right? So what we kind of learned, and here's a little insight for you all, here's your first little nugget, right? And you might have heard this from marketing research, but there's not just one type of developer, right? There's seasoned one, there's newbies, there's we sometimes refer to as the guy and his dog, if it's maybe we're an audience for commerce, but maybe for enterprise, we need a different type of developer. And there's actually then, there's the integrated type developers that are really going in and digging in those docs, trying to figure out how to code this thing. But then there's the CTO who's the decision maker. So again, when I referenced before about just get me to the code, they're bottom up type developers. Like I don't read, I don't want to, I just want to kind of get my hands dirty on the code. And then if I really need to, I'll figure it out. And then also, what does that tell you? That also starts to tell you when you write documentation, maybe you don't need to be so linear that you need to start to look at developers can approach your documentation at different points. Like right now I just need the authentication. Or right now I just need to know where I can consume it in the gateway. Or right now, yes, I'm new, so I need to understand from a getting started perspective. So really learning your different developers and their specific type they are in the audience is such a key thing. Now, another go-to thing we love is competitive analysis. Now, I'd love to say why this is important is because you can start to develop a shorthand with their mental models. Like how, when you look at a navigation, for instance, and you look at a word community or products or solutions, or do we call it just APIs, you can actually look at your competitors, and sometimes that navigational titles can really already start being a shorthand of, oh, I know what I understand I'll find when I go into that page, right? Now, saying that, I also still always warn, don't just rely on competitive analysis, because sometimes you don't know what these other basically competitors have for resources. Are they really using research? Are they really talking to their developers? Maybe we're all just following each other. And again, we might miss opportunities and going out of the box and finding new exciting approaches. So I think it's a huge important and one of the cheapest ways to get started. But yet I also recommend looking and trying to do your own type studies and finding, really searching for opportunities to make you different from your competitors. Surveys is another thing you can do, especially individual APIs and the docs. You can start combining everything from your qualitative to this quantitative to understand, like, if they're bouncing, maybe these surveys can start telling you that your documentation is still not up to snuff, or you haven't really got them to what they want, you know? So there's a lot of things you can learn if you can start implementing, and there's like sometimes really software, open software even, that can help really get you some of these services you may need. Analytics, once again, is another piece. If you can start building and start knowing which ones are popular, which ones they're bouncing, how long they're staying on a site, these are all critical. And personas, again, being specific about your user. Now this, some of you, this might be cliche, you might start hearing this a lot, but it really makes a difference. Like I really see, and I've learned, our team has learned, our researcher, everything, there's different personas here that we're actually not just speaking to a developer. We're speaking to, you know, think about the journey here, right? If you have, maybe the business owner is the first one, someone that owns this application or owns the solution they're looking for. Are they really the decision maker? Maybe though, they're probably asking the CTO or the tech lead to go and judge your security of, or how vetted your code is, right? And then you have a developer who maybe really is the one then that goes and interacts with your developer. And here's an example, though, that what why I actually personally love this space is because you also have all the other developers. And sometimes we're often building just this kind of what I call brochureware in developer portals, like a handful of developers. But sometimes we're also, if we're looking for, you're getting mature and you're looking for the maturity of building up an infrastructure to support your portals, you're then also starting to look at areas of how to publish these APIs, how to publish the docs, how to create approval workflow. How are we creating the efficiency and starting to automate all this process? So how we start to discover that is sometimes in these areas of customer journeys. They're called user flows, sometimes customer journeys, user mapping. But what I love especially is something sometimes an extension of customer journey, which is called a service blueprint, because you can take the front stage, backstage employees, say the people that are interacting. Let's say we already take that developer, right? And you're who are the people that are interacting with that developer? Is there still a manual process happening? Like we have like sales managers that are talking to these business owners. Can that be automated by creating a marketing experience, or the developer who's dealing with the onboarding or the integration? Is that still happening manual? You know, how are you publishing these APIs and these docs? If the more you start learning of all that manual opportunities that could maybe be turned into automation or online experiences, the more we're gonna really, the key thing is we're gonna basically remove the frictionless experience for our developers, our partners, and onboarding of new clients. So this is an incredibly valuable thing to work through. I also love sharing this, right? Taking that customer journey and then finally really mapping it out with sketching. And then, you know, and I actually show here the example of one of our very early portals we first did a redesign for. And why I love this, again, many of you probably have built developed portals, but if you're still new into your process of this, what I love this industry is because it's such a diverse kind of work I'm trying to do. You've got marketing, you have documentation. How do you create like very usable, easy to understand and read documentation? How do you create the communication you need? Of how do you get started? What do you need to do first? You know, with maybe something like a dashboard. Equally, we do things from test case management to other type workflows to help our users more automate the self-service experience. So, you know, once you take all that discovery work and synthesize, you can start the ideation process. And I'll go quickly through this. So you can take that and you synthesize all those needs. You can bring, what I love to do is bring your product owners and your tech owners into a whole session to try to really now sketch some of the best concepts. You can look at something like Google Design Sprints, or another one I love is Design Studio. And come up kind of reverse, like diverge, then you converge. Like the real key thing is sometimes not just be that follower, as we saw in this competitive analysis, but to really go out a little bit of the box and see if there's other opportunities that really we might discover here and really find some great new experiences. So then of course you prototype your hypotheses, and then you start to test that. And I'm big on very incremental deliveries, like go for the long term, get little quick wins, get it out there and keep iterating and growing your experiences. So for design, I'm just going to show some insights. You know, maybe you already know design thinking, maybe you want to know some stuff. But again, if you look at all the key areas of building a great developer experience, yes, even though I just said marketing fluff, there's three areas you really need sometimes. You need to look at the business owner. They might need some handholding, some real explaining of the value proposition of why you're the better competitor for whatever reason. But then you need to then focus also on that CTO, who is that decision maker and needs to know more about those security and how vetted. And truth of the matter is sometimes really what they want is there's some areas, what's called a whole new exciting area of developer advocacy, where they're looking and examining. It's not that they don't like marketing these developers, it's that they are smarter than the marketers, right? So what they have found, all these developer advocates, is community of peers, in a way, is that marketing opportunity, showing great APIs, what they're doing, showing partners that maybe can use it, showing like real creativity and excitement of new areas in work you're doing, is really almost like those kind of article driven how to's and great examples and case studies and use cases, really is marketing to a developer. And just a great tip for you all if you haven't discovered that. So again, don't forget your business owner and what that program is. Really look at your outreach program for developers. Can you build a community? Can you find that beeline to the code, you know, but still also have some overviews or some more, you know, for the kind of more less seasoned, more explanations if they need it. You want to look at the mental model of how you are going to scale with all your APIs, and be careful that you're not, this might be a specific problem to banks, right? Especially us that are trying to be this enterprise across the entire organization, and that could be quite large. We have internal and we have external, and we have other businesses, right? We're trying to do from partners to public, eventually open banking to private, a lot of reusable APIs. So we got to look at the different, we got to always look at both the external and the internal point of view and their mental models and how they might filter these APIs to really, because all they're looking for is a very task-driven capability. And how do we help them find that in the quickest way possible? Because of course, once again, going back to original quiz, the efficiency and impatience, got to get to them, connect with them quick. So you might come up with that filtering system. Landing page, you want to look at a communication and how you are really getting them in that different pathways. Are you a publisher? Are you a consumer? Where's your direct pathways? How do you get them to know what they need to do first versus how to get started? What are more product opportunities? And yes, you still also might need some of that marketing stuff, like, hey, maybe there's a new SDK along with that API. You got to look for those opportunities, but not obstruct with those opportunities, right? Get them to what they need. You got to look at onboarding and self-service. Remove the friction from them. They don't really want a lot of hand-holding most of the time, we've learned. They really want to be able to just go in and do this, and it should be easy to understand and easy to follow. And so you got to really work towards that. And again, eventually, as you mature as a product, you need to start looking also, you know, you could maybe just build these as HTML experiences, what I call brochureware, but you got to start eventually looking at your content management system, how you're publishing these APIs. Are you being portal first into the integration into the gateway? Do you have a workflow approval type system to make sure? And are you finding ways to score your APIs and come up with a governance for your APIs? And again, so I'm hoping I still have time, but I will give you a few last things just in case you want some great research things we've learned. Developers expect a simple visual presentation that can be scanned for key information as well as clear pathways to try an API code. So again, that going from that stock image to maybe a kind of minimalism and keeping it very simple and really driving them into the right directions of what we know they want is really important in a developer portal. Developers are focused on their work. They want to be able to evaluate an API without having to jump hoops. We gotta remove that friction, guys. We gotta get that to that self-service automation. We're still early in our journey, believe it or not, but there's a lot of excitement and still a lot of jobs to be done in our work, and I'm sure with all, you all. It's just an unending, incredible space we all work in. Developers learn best from getting their hands on code. I think I've kind of driven that home plenty of times. But at the same time, yes, sometimes for those business owners, for a little bit of integrated type developers, they still might need some of that getting started, the APIs. You just want to find the way to not have it so abstracted, like have it a linear experience. Like, I got to read through all this first. You got to think about content strategy. In fact, I usually often think content strategy along with marketing, but especially along with the subject matter expert, finding that triad is something I highly recommend. And it's been some of the biggest lessons learned, some of the early failures, but but we were able to really advocate and turn around with the strength and needing content strategy along with tech writers, along with the marketers. And developers finally rely on their peers, you know, so build that community, communicate, get those articles out, all the great work you're doing, and showing what your product is capable of and what kind of innovative work you're doing. And that's it. And I just, I hope I filled my time. I hope I didn't go over. And I'm sorry that I was late a little bit and going through all these technical problems, but thank you very, very much, everyone. I really appreciate your time. Now I got to figure out how to stop sharing.
All right. Thank you so much, Deborah. That was a fantastic presentation. And I apologize to everybody if I'm way too loud right now. My mic's way too loud. But I especially loved the points you made about bringing a lot of empathy to the developer experience, you know, understanding what the developer needs to get through their day and everything. That's fantastic. Cool. Well, we have one more talk on the developer experience track coming up. Thank you again, Deborah, so much. I'm gonna take you off stage here. It's kind of weird, the etiquette of hosting a virtual conference. It's kind of odd a little bit, but thank you so much, Deborah. Round of applause for her. Everyone's applauding, I'm sure, everywhere. Thank you so much, Deborah.